So welcome, Sandeep sir, to Everything Azure. And in this podcast series, we are going to talk about the most basic questions that are given about Azure. And we're going to transition from, let's say, basic questions to advanced questions and so on and so forth.
So basically, I'm assuming that this particular podcast will help all the Azure seekers about any kind of questions which they have in getting clarity on the subject more. I believe that is the main goal of this particular podcast. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, and the best part is we are going to keep it strictly technical.
Perfect. Absolutely perfect.
Let me start off with one of the most important topics, I would say, in Azure, which is virtual networking. Every role in Azure has to know virtual networking. One of the most common questions in virtual networking that I am assuming is, why are there different subnets in a particular VNet?
Okay, fantastic. A very good question to begin with, actually. See, in Azure, we create a virtual network. And then in the virtual network, we are going to create all our virtual machines. And in these virtual machines, we are going to deploy various kind of workloads, which can be your web servers, which can be database servers, application servers, and many other servers which are required for every corporate network. Now imagine you are going to do a lift and shift of your entire on-prem application into Azure cloud. And when you do that, you don't want everything to be accessible to internet. You want to create DMZ, demilitarized zones, where you would like to put certain workload which you would like to get access through internet. And there can be certain workloads which are like not at all accessible to internet, but accessible to other virtual machines within the same network. For example, if I take a web server, should be accessible to internet, but a database server shouldn't be accessible to internet, but should be accessible to the application which is running on a web server. So in these kind of scenario, we need to have different security settings for web servers and database servers. And that we can achieve by introducing different types of NSGs or let's say firewall. Now if you are taking NSG, you can put the NSG at the subnet level and you can set the inbound rules and outbound rules for that particular NSG. So the subnet, which is exposed to internet, we also call it as the DMZ. There I can have rules which will allow certain type of traffic into the virtual machines which are part of that subnet. But the virtual machines which are, let's say, database servers will be in different subnet and the corresponding NSG is not going to allow traffic from internet. So like this, basically different level of security is one reason. Then we would like to have different subnets dedicated for certain types of services. So sometimes imagine your PaaS services, you want to have access to internet or let's say access to VNet. Imagine app service, you would like to have access to VNet. So you would put app service in one subnet. Like that, you can have subnets dedicated to the gateway. You can have subnets which are dedicated to the virtual appliances. So for the type of use case and the kind of network traffic flow which we want to have, we would want to have the different subnets created. So majorly, in short, if I tell you, security and route tables are what we will always configure at the subnet level, and they can be different for different type of workloads. And that's how the big virtual network should be split into multiple subnets.
So let me set a ground for the viewers. From what I understand over here is that we have a virtual network and we are basically trying to combine different resources which belong to one particular task, I would say, in one particular.
That's what we actually call it as workloads.
Workloads.
So web servers is one type of workload.
Okay. And database servers,
again, a different type of workload. And sometimes if an application is built using N-tier architecture, we may also have application servers.
Let me backtrack a little. What is an N-tier architecture?
Oh, it's again an architecture which the developers use for splitting the application into multiple layers. And each of these layers can be on different virtual machines.
So this can also be into different subnets in the virtual network?
You can, if you can do that. Yes, it can be. Actually, it can be an ideal solution. You can put all your front end in one subnet, your back end in a different subnet, an application layer in a different subnet, and restrict the traffic so that the traffic goes to the database server only via application server, and the traffic to the application server can go only via web server. web server trying to access database server should not be allowed. So these kind of configurations can be done through NSGs.
So basically more granular control and security over the particular VNet, and that's why we are introducing more subnets.
Exactly, you can say that. And there is one more reason, which is route tables. We do create route tables which will control how the traffic goes out of a particular virtual machine based on the subnet to which that virtual machine belongs, because route tables are connected to the subnet. We create a route table. Route table has got multiple routes. Each route is about a rule of if the traffic comes from here and if it is targeted to this, where should the next hop of the packet should be.
So basically like an intermediate destination through exactly. which it should pass before going to the actual destination.
Precisely. And that can be a virtual appliance. And the validation of the data can be performed in the virtual appliance. And route tables can ensure that the traffic going out of the virtual machines from a given subnet is always routed to virtual appliance rather than to the direct target. So that is also one major use case of the subnets.
One another question that I had for you is, let's say I have a particular situation wherein I only need one subnet. Is that a desirable situation?
Absolutely not. If you have a very, very, very basic network, you just create one virtual network and one subnet and put all your workload in that one subnet. You're not then splitting your virtual network for different security layers. A very simplified network can be something like that.
So when does it get a little too much for it to be handled in one particular subnet?
I mean, it's generally not advisable because any real-time network will always have different type of workloads with different security
and
options.
Complexity.
And complexity will be there. I mean, if you're doing practice and doing some case studies or some proof of concept and you're not too much worried about the security and the routes and the virtual appliances and these kind of things, then you may go for simple virtual network with one subnet. But one subnet is mandatory for every virtual network.
So the virtual machine that is in the particular VNet has to be associated with the subnet. It cannot exist without the subnet.
Exactly. Every virtual machine has to be part of a subnet. But here actually is a big confusion. See, virtual machines are never part of a subnet. It's something very important the audience should listen to. Everyone says virtual machine belongs to a subnet, but that's wrong. Every virtual machine can have a NIC associated, network card which is associated with it. And it is the network card which will have a IP address. That can be a private IP address and optional, may or may not be there, a public IP address. And the network card IP address will be selected from one of the subnets in the VNet. Now the funny thing is, a machine can have multiple network interface card.
One virtual machine can
machine can have multiple network interface card.
And they can exist in two different
and
subnets?
And both the virtual network, both the NICs, network interface card, can belong to different subnets.
Wow.
So based on how the application is selecting the NIC, how does application communicate with other application? It's a socket they have to create. What is socket? A combination of IP address and port number. Now you select NIC 1 or you select NIC 2. Their IP address is different. So if you select the IP address of NIC 1 and you send the request, it will be request sent via the subnet of NIC 1 IP. And if you select the IP address of NIC 2 for creating your socket, the request is routed via subnet of NIC 2. And NIC 1 and NIC 2 IP addresses can come from different subnet. They don't have to be in same subnet. So the applications which are running within the same virtual machine can have a choice of choosing NIC 1 IP or NIC 2 IP and accordingly do the communication with the external applications. I mean, machines other than that.
So while this might be a possibility in Azure, is this an actual real-time use case scenario? Because I am assuming that an organization would rather prefer to have two different virtual machines with different NICs rather than grouping them into one and virtual machine having two different NICs with the same virtual machine in two different subnets.
See, when you have less workload on a particular, imagine the case of web server. Now you can have one web server hosting multiple websites. And when we are configuring a website, we have to choose on which IP address it is going to receive the request.
True.
Now you can configure your web servers in such a way that whether the request comes from site 1 or site 2, all of them land on the same IP address. That means only one NIC is sufficient. That means the DNS server of the domain 1 and the DNS server for domain 2 is mapping to the same IP. In other words, in DNS server, domain 1 and domain 2 both are mapping to same IP. So the public sending a request for domain 1 or public sending a request for domain 2 in either case goes to the same IP and the same application is able to receive the request. Now the question arises, is it for site 1 or is it for site 2? So generally what happens is in the browser, along with the request, the domain name is also included. Domain name to IP is resolved by DNS, but domain name is also included as one of the request headers in the request. And the web server will look at the domain name and map the request to either site 1 or site 2. So domain name to site 1, domain 1 to site 1, domain 2 to site 2, IP address is same.
So this can be possible with one NIC.
This is possible with one NIC only. You don't need more than one NIC in this case. But then what is happening? The TCP queue, which is on the NIC, is being shared by both the websites along with all the resources of that virtual machine. The TCP queue is shared by both the websites. And like this, you may have multiple websites hosted on the same web server. And this can become a bottleneck. So exactly.
That is why we introduced two different NICs.
So now what happens? Suppose we have enough amount of resources on the virtual machine, but we want to have different traffic for domain 1 and domain 2. We can go for two different NICs.
Perfect.
And their IPs will be different. And the web server can be configured in such a way that if a request comes on this IP, port number 80, or 443, redirect to site 1. And if the request comes from domain 2, a different IP, and again port number can be 80 or 443 based on the protocol, redirect the traffic to site 2. So you can have different NICs, same web server, handling different websites because they are coming on different IPs through different NIC. So like this, we can have multiple applications. I'm taking here only one web server. You can have multiple independent applications running, dealing with their traffic independently if there are multiple NICs on the same machine. The ultimate solution can be for every website you create a separate server, and that can be expensive.
Exactly.
Because the compute resources will have to be allocated to each one of them, and your all websites may not have the load at all the times. So to cut the cost, you might have one web server, and in case needed, we don't want to block one web server, one website users from the other website users. We can simply go for multiple domains, multiple NICs, common web server, common compute resource. So these are all pros and cons. I mean, you'll have to work out on the architecture based on how much the traffic is going to be, how much is the compute resources available, how much time the requests are executing. All these parameters we have to study and then make a decision on that. Of course, cost has to be considered at all the levels.
So from what I understand right now, it's security is one thing. The reasons being why we choose different subnets. The first thing is security. The second thing is segregation of workloads. The third thing that comes into play is cost management.
Cost management is not because of the subnet, but yeah, you can say you want to reuse the same virtual machine through different subnets and put different security restrictions.
That was great insight. Actually got to know a lot about how different NICs can be associated in different subnets as well. So let's meet in the next session and continue this series.
Thank you.